إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. We have the class of tafsir inshallah from Surah Al-Baqarah from verse 220. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم في الدنيا والآخرة. ويسألونك عن اليتامى قل إصلاح لهم خير وإن تخالطوهم فإخوانكم والله يعلم المفسد من المصلح ولو شاء الله لأعنتكم إن الله عزيز حكيم. قال الإمام الشيخ عبد الرحمن السعدي رحمه الله في قول الله عز وجل: في الدنيا والآخرة ويسألونك عن اليتامى قل إصلاح لهم خير كذلك يبين الله لكم الآيات لعلكم تتفكرون، أي دلالات على الحق المحصلات للعلم النافع والفرقان، كذلك يبين الله لكم الآيات لعلكم تتفكرون في الدنيا والآخرة، أي لكي تستعملوا أفكاركم في أسرار شرعه وتعرف أن أوامره فيها مصالح الدنيا والآخرة، وأيضا لكي تتفكروا في الدنيا وسرعة انقضائها فترفضوها، وفي الآخرة وبقائها وأنها دار الجزاء فتعمروها. In this ayah, verse 19, the end of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كذلك يبين الله لكم الآيات. That's verse number 19, the end of it. كذلك يبين الله لكم الآيات. Thus Allah makes clear to you His laws in order that you may give thought في الدنيا والآخرة into this worldly life and in the hereafter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes his ayat clear to you so you think deeply in the issue of in the worldly life and in the hereafter. Sheikh Sa'di says, rahimahullah, what means you think deeply in the laws of Allah, the commands of Allah, what Allah has ordained, to know that the commandments of Allah Azza wa Jal is for the worldly benefits and for the hereafter benefit. Means there is your benefit, there is your success, is your favor to apply the command of Allah because of your masalih al-dunya wa masalih al-akhirah. So what Allah command, subhanahu wa ta'ala, what Allah legislate from His laws is on order Allah Azza wa Jalla to rectify our worldly life and our hereafter life to make it better في الدنيا والآخرة. So all the rules of Allah is for the well-being of our worldly life and the well-being of our hereafter. Also, the Sheikh said, تتفكرون, to think deeply in the worldly life and the hereafter في الدنيا والآخرة, to remember that this worldly life is a passing life, it's a quick passing life, ending life, while on the other hand, the Akhirah is continuous life. In life, there is a reward, Hayatul Jaza. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made his ayat, كَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمَ الْآيَاتِ, made his verses clear to you, لِكَيْ تَتَفَكَّرُونَ, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَفَكَّرُونَ, to ponder and to think deeply in في الدنيا والآخرة. The rules of Allah relating to the laws of Allah, to find out and to realize and to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated for the well-being of your life here and the hereafter. And also to think the laws of Allah azza wa jal, to find out that the worldly life is short and is ending, and the hereafter is everlasting, is continuous, and is better and bigger. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْيَتَامَى قُلْ إِصْلَاحُ لَهُمْ خَيْرٌ. يقول الإمام الشيخ سعد رحمه الله في قول الله عز وجل, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْيَتَامَى قُلْ إِصْلَاحُ لَهُمْ خَيْرٌ. لما نزل قوله تعالى, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ أَمْوَالَ الْيَتَامَى ظُلْمًا إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُونَ فِي بُطُونِهِمْ نَارًا وسيصلون سعيرا, شق ذلك على المسلمين وعزلوا طعامهم عن طعام اليتامى خوفا على أنفسهم من تناولها, ولو في هذه الحالة التي جرت العادة بالمشاركة فيها. وسألوا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن ذلك فأخبرهم تعالى أن المقصود إصلاح أموال اليتامى بحفظها وصيانتها والاتجار فيها, وأن خلطهم إياهم في طعام أو غيره جائز على وجه لا يضر باليتامى, لأنه إخوانكم ومن شأن الأخ مخالطة أخيه, والمرجع في ذلك إلى النية والعمل. فمن علم الله من نيته أنه مصلح لليتيم وليس له طمع في ماله, فلو دخل عليه شيء من غير قصد لم يكن عليه بأس. ومن علم الله من نيته أن قصده بالمخالطة التوصل إلى أكلها وتناولها فذلك الذي حرج وأثم, والوسائل لها أحكام المقاصد. وفي هذه الآية دليل على جواز أنواع المخالطات في المآكل والمشارب والعقود وغيرها, وهذه رخصة لطف من الله تعالى وإحسان وتوسعة على المؤمنين, وإلا فلو شاء الله لأعنتكم, أي شق عليكم بعدم الرخصة بذلك فحرجتم وشق عليكم وأثمتم. إن الله عزيز, أي له القوة الكاملة والقهر لكل شيء, ولكنه مع ذلك حكيم لا يفعل إلا ما هو مقتضى حكمته الكاملة وعنايته التامة, فعزته لا تنافي حكمته, فلا يقال إنه ما شاء فعل وافق الحكمة أو خالفها, بل يقال إن أفعاله وكذلك أحكامه تابعة لحكمته, فلا يخلق شيئا عبثا, بل لا بد له من حكمة عرفناها أم لم نعرفها. وكذلك لم يشرع لعباده شيئا مجردا عن الحكمة, فلا يأمر إلا بما فيه مصلحة خالصة أو راجحة, ولا ينهى إلا عما فيه مفسدة خالصة أو راجحة لتمام حكمته ورحمته. الله سبحانه وتعالى سأل in this ayah, ويسألونك عن اليتامى, verse 220, ويسألونك عن اليتامى قل إصلاح لهم خير. And they ask you, means all the message of Allah Muhammad, concerning orphans. They ask you concerning orphans. قل إصلاح لهم خير. Say, the best thing is to work honestly in their property. وَإِن تُخَالِطُوهُمْ فَإِخْوَانُكُمْ. And if you mix your affairs with theirs, then they are your brothers. والله يعلم المفسد من المصلح. Allah knows him who means mischief to swallow their property from him who means good to save their property. إن الله عزيز ولو شاء الله لعنتكم. And if Allah had wished, he could have put you into difficulties. والله عز إن الله عزيز حكيم. Truly Allah is almighty, all wise. In this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْيَتَامَ. And they ask you, means all the Messenger of Allah Muhammad, means the believers, ask you about عَنِ الْيَتَامَ, concerning orphans. There is another verse in Surah An-Nisa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the ruling of the one who consume wrongly eat the property of the orphan. And that person is in reality by eating and consuming the wealth of the orphan, he really eating a fire. He really eating إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُونَ فِي بُطُونِهِمْ نَارًا أي نَارًا فِي بُطُونِهِمْ. So those who wrong the orphan and misuse their wealth, the punishment is that they are eating fire. It means in the day of judgment. This is their punishment. When Allah revealed this verse, it was hard on the companion of the Prophet ﷺ, who used to fear Allah so much. Those who in their hand was the wealth of the orphan. The orphan is the one who his father died before the age of puberty and didn't reach yet the age of puberty. That is the orphan. So the Sahaba, if one of them dies and he leaves behind orphans, someone used to take care of his wealth, of their property, to which they inherit from their father, or they had it through another ways. And because the orphan cannot take care of his property, there should be someone who in charge of it. But when Allah revealed this verse, the ruling of the one who consume, who misuse the wealth of the property, eat the property of the orphan, that is in reality is eating fire. Sahaba, they fear. They came to the Prophet ﷺ. They say, oh, the Messenger of Allah, what do we do? Because if you have both the food of the orphan and you have your own food, if food is cooked, if all of the food is put into the one plate and they like to eat together, which is the sunnah, to eat the food together, not like what we do, everyone has his own plate, rather to share the food as much as can be shared. Then, and the food is from the food of the orphan and from your own food, then the person may eat the food of the orphan. And the like, and mixing the food together. What is the ruling? What do we do? Because we may, by mistake, while we are honest, it may happen that some of the food of the property of the orphan may go into us. And this is the punishment. What do we do? Allah revealed this ayah. Allah said, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْيَتَامَ. They ask you concerning the orphans. قُلْ إِصْلَاحُ لَهُمْ خَيْرٍ. Say, the best thing is to work honestly in their property. Meaning, as long you are holding the property of the orphan for that which is benefit for them, for being mada honest for them, not using their wealth, rather to either work honestly in their property or to preserve it, to keep it. If this is what you're doing, that's good. Nothing is wrong with that. وَإِن تُخَالِطُوهُمْ فَإِخْوَانُكُمْ. And if you mix your affairs, meaning your property, with theirs, They are your brothers. And brother doesn't deceive his brother. So deal with one another as brothers. Protect their property. But as for mixing, it's not a problem. As long as there's brotherhood, you are taking care of the orphan, the property of the orphan based on that you are his brother. There's brotherhood. Brother doesn't harm his brother, doesn't deceive his brother. Rather, he is kind to his brother. If this is based on that, this mixing, then فَإِخْوَانُكُمْ. So whatever happened of mistake, when sharing the food or any unintended mistake, then it's forgiven. Otherwise, it will be hard on the believers. How can you take care of the food of the orphan, the property of the orphan, and you are not allowed to mix that with yours? You are not allowed, yani, even by mistake, if something happened by mistake, you eat, what will happen? You eat in fire. It was very. So Allah in this ayah, he mentioned that what happened by mistake is forgiven. What's mean is the one who intend to corrupt the wealth of the property. Allah said, وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ الْمُفْسِدَ مِنَ الْمُصْلِحِ. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ الْمُفْسِدَ مِنَ الْمُصْلِحِ. And Allah knows him who means mischief from him who means good. Allah knows who is mixing his wealth and the wealth of the orphan together, the property of the orphan together, to mischief, to cheat, to deceive the orphan. The one who his intention is that, Allah knows. Yes, orphan doesn't know it. Orphan is a young. You can't even, a person can't even cheat, say, oh, all the property is gone. You, the one who use it, I spend whole property into you. While all this is a lie, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. Not only the actions, rather Allah knows even the intention. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ الْمُفْسِدَ مِنَ الْمُصْلِحِ. So you're dealing with Allah Azza wa Jal, not an orphan. If you intend good, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forgiving you for whatever happened because of mistake. As long as you're honest and you want good for the orphan, either to protect and preserve his wealth or to work in it so it can grow, to invest it. For that which is benefit for the property of the orphan. وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَأَعْنَتَكُمْ. Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَأَعْنَتَكُمْ. And if Allah had wished, he could have put you into difficulties. Means even though you must keep the property of the wealth of the orphan, and someone must be in charge of it, but yet if it happened by his mistake, person is here in fire. If this would have happened, it would have been difficult on the believers. But Allah makes it easy. Mix your property with theirs with the intention that to protect the property of the orphan and to all do favor for it. Not to misuse it, not to. In another ayah in Surah An-Nisa, Allah divides people into two. Someone who is sufficient, he suffices himself from the wealth of the property. He doesn't need it. It's better not to use whatsoever from the property of the orphan. Nothing. Even though he's working, he's putting his time, his energy for the benefit of the orphan, but yet it's better not to take anything from the orphan's wealth. But if the person is faqir, is poor, and he is protecting and preserving the wealth of the orphan, spending his time, his energy, then now is allowed to eat from it, according to ma'ruf. فَمَنْ كَانَ غَنِيًّا فَلْيَسْتَعْفِفْ وَمَنْ كَانَ فَقِيرًا فَلْيَأْكُلْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ فَإِذَا دَفَعْتُمْ إِلَيْهِمْ أَمْوَالَهُمْ فَأَشِدُوا عَلَيْهِ وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ حَسِيبًا وَآتُوا الْيَتَامَى أَمْوَالَهُمْ وَلَا تَتَبَدَّلُوا الْخَبِيثَ بِالطَّيِّبِ وَلَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَهُمْ إِلَى أَمْوَالِكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ حُوبًا كَبِيرًا وَلَا تُؤْتُوا السُّفَهَاءَ أَمْوَالَكُمُ الَّتِي جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ قِيَامًا وَارْزُقُوهُمْ فِيهَا وَاكْسُوهُمْ وَقُولُوا لَهُمْ قَوْلًا مَّعْرُوفًا. خذوا زايا وابتلوا اليتامى جزاك الله خير حتى إذا بلغوا النكاح فإن آنستم منهم رشدا فادفعوا إليهم أموالهم. You protected the orphan as well, property, until he reached the age of property, he she can take care of his her wealth. Now give their wealth and make a witness. ولا تأكلوها إسرافا وبدارا أن يكبروا ومن كان غنيا فليستعفف ومن كان فقيرا فليأكل بالمعروف. So whoever Allah suffices him, even though he is working for the well-being of the orphan's property, but still he leave it. But for من كان فقير poor and the orphan's property in his hand, now to eat from it, that which is معروف, that which is good. Now that which is good. And this is a proof for how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala azza wa jal is kind, is merciful to his servants. How many verses, how many ayah, how many hadith concerning the issue of the orphan, to take care of the orphan, to expand to the orphan, to protect the orphan, to put peace and happiness in the heart of the orphan. Prophet ﷺ said, "Ana wa kafir al-yatim kahatin." I am the one who make a kafir al-yatim. What is kafir al-yatim? The one who what? Yes. Garden the orphan is the one who kafir, yani take care of the orphan. Allah Prophet ﷺ said, "The one who take care of the orphan, help him grow." Naam. He and me, the Prophet ﷺ said, we are like this, fil Jannah, in the Jannah. The Prophet is a little bit ahead, that person in the Jannah. So the person is in the Jannah, and he is with the Prophet ﷺ, but the Prophet ﷺ is a little bit ahead of him. This is how great it is to take care of the orphan, until they stand on their feet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, والله يعلم المفسد من المصلح ولو شاء الله لعنتكم إن الله عزيز حكيم. Truly Allah is almighty, all wise. عزيز, Allah is almighty, powerful, سبحانه وتعالى. Whatever he سبحانه وتعالى wants takes place. This is the description of Allah only. No one else has this description. فعال لما يريد. Whatever Allah wants, it takes place. Whatever Allah wants takes place. No one else. Whatever He wants takes place. إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا أَنْ يَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. If Allah wants something to be, He says be, is going to be. All of it. So Allah is Aziz, powerful, سبحانه وتعالى. But with that, Allah is Hakim, all wise. So He, سبحانه وتعالى, عز وجل, doesn't use his power into the wrong way, rather upon the hikmah, the wisdom, wherever it deserves the power. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Hakim. So whatever Allah command in the universal command, whatever you see, earthquake, whatever you see in this universe, someone dies, someone born, all is based on hikmah, whether we understand or we don't understand. Likewise, whatever Allah command, whatever Allah legislate, cutting the hand of the thief, hijab, not drinking alcohol, praying five prayers, such all the rules of Allah is based on hikmah, wisdom. Whether we understand or we don't understand. Hakim. So never question Allah Azza wa Jal, why such happen? Why such wouldn't happen? Why Allah legislate this? Why Allah wouldn't legislate this? The time you have this, you say, Wallahu Azizun Hakim. Allah Azza wa Jal is Aziz, all powerful, almighty. Subhanah. Nothing prevents itself from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Hakim, all wise, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything. Yes, sometimes it may seem to us, we may not understand the hikmah. Rather, we may say, this shouldn't be how this could have been. But if we would have enough knowledge, we could know that That is the haq and the truth. And remember always in this issue, Surah to Yusuf, what happened between Prophet Musa and Al-Khidr. Al-Khidr, Allah gave him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, some knowledge, unseen knowledge, from the unseen knowledge, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to Prophet Musa. Even though Prophet Musa had knowledge that was not given to Al-Khidr, as the hadith is. So generally, Prophet Musa was more knowledgeable, was much bigger, more honorable than Al-Khidr. Prophet Musa is one of the Ulul Azm in al-Rusul, one of the five biggest messengers. But yet, there was a knowledge who was not given to Prophet Musa, but with Khidr, Al-Khidr. So from that knowledge is, when Khidr killed that little boy, innocent boy, Prophet Musa is surprised. How you kill? أقتلت نفسا زكية بغير نفس لقد جئت شيئا نكرا. You kill an innocent soul. So Al-Khidr, he didn't do that because of him. وما فعلت عن أمري. That's what he said. I didn't do it because of my command. Means I have been commanded by Allah. I did this because Allah commanded me to kill that little boy. And what is the hikmah, what is the wisdom? Is because Allah's knowledge, through Allah's knowledge, if this boy would have lived until he grows up, he could have corrupted himself with shirk and kufr, and also would have corrupted his father and mother who were Muslims. All would have been kuffar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of his mercy, he showed mercy to those two parents. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took away that boy, and anyone will die anyway, other than Allah. Kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut. Even if this little boy live forever, for 1,000 years, still he will die. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the soul of that little boy in order to replace for his two parents a better child. And that is what happened. They had a better child. He grew up. He was very kind, very nice, very care to his two parents who were Muslims. All they are people of Jannah. But Prophet Musa alayhi salam and anyone else who is not given that hidden knowledge, which is because of it this little boy is being killed, he questioned how it happened. How a little boy is being killed with no sin. Wow. Yes, that is the reality. But you don't understand. So this is the example. Whatever Allah command in the universal command, what happened on the universe, galaxies, stars, huge creation of Allah, animals, oceans, name it, whatever Allah create, Allah create based on hikmah. Don't question. لا يسأل عما يفعل. Allah is not asked what he does, because there is no need of asking. It's based on hikmah. Also the religion, the legislative command, whatever Allah legislate in his religion, whatever you may think, oh, this would have been better, wouldn't be legislated if this would have been on this, this verse would have been for the other one, this surah would have been the beginning, Allah would have legislated this, this wouldn't be, all this is from shaitan, it's from ignorance, it's from ignorance. We would have enough knowledge, we would have hikmah, we would have know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala azza wa jalla legislate only that which is upon wisdom. Wallahu azizun hakeem. So always question yourself, don't question Allah azza wa jal. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا تَنْكِحُ الْمُشْرِكَاتِ حَتَّى يُؤْمِنْ وَلَا أَمَةٌ مُؤْمِنَةٌ خَيْرٌ مِنْ مُشْرِكَةٍ ولو أعجبتكم ولا تنكح المشركين حتى يؤمنوا ولا عبد مؤمن خير من مشرك ولو أعجبكم أولئك يدعون إلى النار والله يدعو إلى الجنة والمغفرة بإذنه ويبين آياته للناس لعلهم يتذكرون.
And do not marry and do not marry al mushrikat, the idolatresses, etc., till they believe and worship Allah alone. And indeed, a slave woman who believes is better than a free mushrika, idolatress, etc., even though she pleases you. And give not your daughters in marriage to al mushrikun, till they believe in Allah alone. And verily, a believing slave is better than a free mushrik, idolater, even though he pleases you. Those al-mushrikun invite you to the fire, but Allah invites you to paradise and forgiveness by his leave, and makes his ayat, proofs, evidences, verses, lessons, signs, revelations, etc., clear to mankind that they may remember.
قال الإمام الشيخ عبد الرحمن السعدي في هذه الآية بقول الله عز وجل ولا تنكح المشركات حتى يؤمن ولا تنكح المشركات حتى يؤمن ما دمنا على شركهن حتى يؤمن لأن المؤمنة ولو بلغت من الدمامة دمامة ما بلغت خير من المشركة ولو بلغت من الحسن ما بلغت وهذه عامة في جميع النساء المشركات وخصصتها آية المائدة في إباحة النساء أهل الكتاب كما قال تعالى والمحصنات من الذين أوتوا الكتاب ولا تنكح المشركين حتى يؤمنوا وهذا عام لا تخصيص فيه ثم ذكر تعالى الحكمة في تحريم نكاح المسلم أو المسلمة لما خالفهما في الدين فقال أولئك يدعون إلى النار أي في أقوالهم أو أفعالهم وأحوالهم فمخالطتهم على خطر منهم والخطر ليس من الأخطار الدنيوية إنما هو الشقاء الأبدي ويستفاد من تعليل الآية النهي عن مخالطة كل مشرك ومبتدع لأنه إذا لم يجوز التزوج مع أن فيه مصالح كثيرة فالخلطة المجردة من باب أولى وخصوصا الخلطة التي فيها ارتفاع المشرك ونحوه على المسلم كالخدمة ونحوها وفي قوله ولا تنكح المشركين ولا تنكح المشركين دليل على اعتبار الولي في النكاح والله يدعو إلى الجنة والمغفرة أي يدعو عباده لتحصيل الجنة والمغفرة التي من آثارها دفع العقوبات وذلك بالدعوة إلى أسبابها من الأعمال الصالحة والتوبة النصوح والعلم النافع والعمل الصالح ويبين الله آيات أي أحكامه وحكمها للناس لعلهم يتذكرون فيوجب لهم ذلك التذكر لما نسوه وعلم ما جهلوه والامتثال لما ضيعوه الله سبحانه وتعالى سير اندس آية سورة البقرة verse 221 ولا تنكحوا المشركات حتى يؤمن ولا تنكحوا المشركات حتى يؤمن and do not marry المشركات the female idol worshippers don't marry or believe in man don't marry those women who are idol worshippers حتى يؤمن until they believe the توحيد they worship Allah alone ولا أمة مؤمنة خير من مشركة ولو أعجبتكم and indeed a slave woman who believes is better than a free مشركة even though she the free مشركة pleases you ولا تنكح المشركات ولا تنكح المشركين حتى يؤمنوا ولا تنكح المشركين ولا تنكح المشركين حتى يؤمنوا نعم and give not means your daughters Give not, means Muslim woman, in marriage to al-mushrikun, to the idol worshippers. Till they believe in Allah alone. And verily, believing a slave is better than a free mushrika, even though he pleases you. أُولَٰئِكَ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى النَّارِ. Those al-mushrikun, the idol worshippers, invite you to the fire. وَاللَّهُ يَدْعُو إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ وَالْمَغْفِرَةِ بِإِذْنِ. But Allah invites you to paradise and forgiveness by His leave. وَيُبَيِّنُ آيَاتِهِ لِلنَّاسِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ. And Allah makes His ayat, His evidence, His proof, His verses, science, revelation, etc., clear to mankind that they may remember. In this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade the believer, believing man, male, to marry non-believing woman, idol worshipper. This verse is general to every idol worshipper, but there is another verse in Surah Al-Ma'idah. Allah made exception the women of the people of the book. The women of the people of the book. That a believer can marry a Christian woman and can marry a Jewish woman. But whoever, the rest, all kinds of disbelievers, is not allowed for a Muslim to marry them. You are not allowed to marry the atheist or to marry a Buddhist or cow worshippers or any other idol worshippers. But the people of the book, the Jewish and the Christian, even though they are idol worshippers as well, is exceptional. For hikmah, wisdom, Allah knows. Allahu Hakim. Don't question. And some of the ulama, they mention one of the hikmah is that the people of the book, if a Muslim husband who is good in his religion marry a Christian woman who is good, not those who commit zina, ayyadan billah, just woman or a Jewish woman, then it's most likely she will accept Islam. Because they have the foundation of the religion. They believe in Allah. They believe in the book. They believe the day of judgment. They believe messengers. With the shirk they have. So if they believe. So unlike the idol worshippers who don't have a book, who don't have the belief, lacking, jazakallahu khair. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made those women exceptional. And Allah mentioned that no matter how beautiful the Christian, how beautiful the idol worshiper woman is, how nice she is in her character, how beautiful in her image, how wealthy she may be or her family, that the believing woman is better, even if she is a slave. Even if she is not beautiful to you. And as for the believing women, they are not allowed to be married by anyone but only believing men. So no Muslimah, jazakallahu khair. So no Muslimah, no believing woman can be married by any non-Muslim. No Christian, no Jewish, no one else can marry a Muslim woman. هَلَّهُنَّ حِلُّ لَهُمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحِلُّونَ لَهُمْ. No exception. When it comes to the Muslim woman, no one can marry but a Muslim. But as for a Muslim man, he cannot marry any idol worshiper, any disbeliever, except the Christian woman and the Jewish woman. So whether you hear today being said, a Muslim woman, she marry a Christian man or she marry atheist, this is not called marriage. This is worse than zina. It's even more evil than adultery and fornication. Because that is known as evil for everybody. But when it said marriage is being given a shape of a religion, is being given a form of a legislation, being considered as a religion, this lie on Allah Azza wa Jal. Therefore, every Muslim woman should know she is not allowed to marry any non-Muslim man. Don't let shaitan deceive you and tell you you have love in this man. Wallahi, that love is not true. Wallahi, هذا من تزيين الشيطان. Wallahi, it's from shaitan. Some women, عياذا بالله, they don't follow the guidelines of the Sharia, avoiding the foreigners, not mixing with them, not talking to them. Unless it's necessary. No talking to them, period, about marriage issue, except with the permission of their parents. Muslim woman is not allowed to chat, to say she want to go after a man and find him. No. She needs marriage, yes. It's from Islam. There's a proper way. Go to your parents. Whoever she hears is interested in her, she tells, go to my father, go to my brother, go to my uncle. Whoever they are from the awliya. Then upon them is to check who is qualified to marry their daughter, who is the right person. Whatever Allah decree is going to take place. Don't try to race with the decree of Allah Azza wa Jal. Just take the proper means, put your trust on Allah. Inna Allah la yudhi'u ajra man ahsana amala. If you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wallahi, Allah promise and doesn't break promise, your ending will be good. Wal aqibatu lil muttaqin. The good ending is for the pious. It may take even a year, even it close to 1,000 years. Like was the case of Prophet Nuh alayhi salam. 950 years patient, calling people to Allah, being humiliated. All that he remained patient until Allah gave him the victory. So, this is a ruling of Islam. It's not allowed for a Muslim woman to marry, but only a Muslim man. So don't say you have love in him. This love is love caused by shaitan, devil. What's with the non-Muslim man? Which a Muslim man doesn't have it. Because you have a Muslim man from all the community. You like someone who is in that color, is in a Muslim. In that money, a Muslim. In that looking, you have in a Muslim. Where do you look? Why are you going to a non-Muslim man? What's with him? At the end of the verse, Allah said, أُولَٰئِكَ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى النَّارِ. Those idol worshippers are calling to fire, to hellfire. So this hikmah that Allah forbade to marry those women because they call into the fire. If it is found that even marrying a Christian woman means calling you to a fire, means calling your offspring, your children to a fire, now the ruling changes. الحكم يدور مع العلة. وجودا وعدما is a Sharia principle. The ruling is based on the wisdom. الحكم يدور مع العلة وجودا وعدما. So if a Christian woman, specific Christian woman, specific Jewish woman, you marry her, she will call you to hellfire. She will call to your children, you call your to your children, hellfire. Then now, أُولَٰئِكَ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى النَّارِ. Don't use the general principle. Even if a Muslim woman, she is not practicing her religion. You marry her, she wants you to drink alcohol with her, to go to the club, to dance with her. أعوذ بالله. She called him to hellfire. Don't marry her. Avoid her. أُولَٰئِكَ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى النَّارِ. أُولَٰئِكَ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى النَّارِ. There are a lot of incidents happen in this country. a Muslim brother, he says, oh, he's going to marry, he's a Christian. Allah allow him to do that. Yes, ya akhi, Allah allow him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. This general rule. But your case, you have to look your special case. Call her, this woman, to Islam. She accepts, alhamdulillah. She refuses. And she, you live in this environment. You have to look your situation. No, I really fell love in her. I cannot even sleep. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. Then what the next thing you hear is he had a girl. He had a son. MashaAllah. Allah bless him with kids. But where do they go? Sundays to the church. Because the mother, she that's what she likes for herself. She thinks that worshiping Jesus saves her from hellfire. She thinks being Muslim put her in a hellfire. So what she loves for herself, she loves for her kids as well, as you are. Especially if the system helping her. Now, this person wakes up, starts sharing tears, crying, what he can do. You can do nothing. Pay all the responsibility. Child support, don't even see them. Pay them so they can learn Christianity, all these kinds. Because you're the one who choose that path. أُولَٰئِكَ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى النَّارِ. How many believing women has no one marrying her? Why are you going to those who are not believing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So, a believer, to be very careful. As for believing women, she is not allowed. She is not allowed to marry someone. Because أُولَٰئِكَ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى النَّارِ. They call to hellfire. How you obey someone? How you mix with someone who call you to hellfire? Sheikh Sa'd said in this ayah to boycott the mushrikun and the innovators. And that mixing with them is a dangerous. It's not allowed to mix with them. With the people of innovation and with the mushrikun. Because it's dangerous. أُولَٰئِكَ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى النَّارِ. وَاللَّهُ يَدْعُوا إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. And Allah Azza wa Jal calls, invites to the Jannah, invites you to the Jannah. أُولَٰئِكَ يَدْعُونَ النَّارِ وَاللَّهُ يَدْعُوا إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invites you to paradise, وَالْمَغْفِرَ and forgiveness, بِإِذْنِهِ, by His leaf. So, hellfire is that thing, example, believing that Jesus saves, that he was crucified to save human beings, that he will save them. And the like, or you marry a Rafida, and she believes Hussein saved you, Ahlul Bayt, the family of Prophet saved you, you just need, oh Hussein, just say, oh Ali, that's it. Or you marry any other one, la, don't marry. Don't marry those who call you to hellfire. Even don't marry Fajira. Even a woman who had aqidah is sound, but she is from those who love the haram. Every night she is in a party. Where is his wife? She already left to Australia. What's there in Australia? A big club is there. Astaghfirullah. Don't marry that woman. Don't marry her because she calling you to hellfire. Wallahu yad'u إلى الجنة والمغفرة بإذنه. الله سبحانه وتعالى said ويبين آياته للناس لعلهم يتذكرون. And Allah makes his ayat clear to mankind that they may remember. So now we learn this from this ayah of Allah, the ruling that a Muslim woman is not allowed to be married by any non-Muslim man. As for the Muslim man, he is allowed to marry from the non-Muslim woman only from the Christian and the Jewish. But if they call him to hellfire, then he avoids, even if she is a Muslim. A specific woman, she calling you to hellfire, iyadan billah, because it's fitna. إنما أموالكم يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن من أزواجكم وأولادكم عدوا لكم. Allah mentioned that some of the believing women and some of their children are enemy to them, let alone not an unbelieving person. Even your believing wife, even your believing child may be enemy to you. فَحْذَرُوهُمْ. Be careful. Be aware of it. So don't obey your wife in everything. Don't obey her in everything. Be cautious. Don't obey your son, your daughter in everything. You have to check what this person asking. Is something pleasing Allah? Something at least permissible? Yes. Something is not allowed? Don't say you're satisfying your wife or you're satisfying your son, your daughter. Satisfy them with haram. Something Allah made clear is not allowed. Don't do that. Because if you do it, then you fell into the fitna. And your enemy, ma'adaw. Bismillah, there was a brother who came to me one time seeking marriage. He wanted to marry a Christian woman. And then there was another one with him. I advised him not to marry her. He said, "Akhi, she's a Nasara. Allah made that permissible." I said, "Hada haq. Walhamdulillah. Wa nu'minu bidhalik." But ya akhi, this specific woman, the environment she is, through experience, she would have lived in Medina and Mecca, in a Muslim land. All the people around her are Muslims. Alhamdulillah, those who visit her are Muslimat. It's different when she live in other environment. So how many Muslim women, alhamdulillah, out there? Married them. Say no, because. And I advised him. He didn't listen. And I say, "I'm not helping you with that. It's permissible, but I'm not helping you with that." Person can't refrain from something which is permissible. You say, "I'm not drinking milk." Yes, it's lawful, but I'm not drinking it. Not, this is not making something impermissible. You don't have to eat, you don't have to involve something which is permissible. As long as you believe, it's permissible. You don't blame someone else involving it. Al-Muhim, it took some time and I couldn't move him. I say, "Okay, if this is the case now, you have another option. Call her to Islam. Bring her to the masjid. Let she hear da'wah. Be given books or nice websites. Give her time." And I told him, if she really loves you the way you claim, inshallah, and she sees the haq, why she doesn't accept it? With the interest she has, worldly interest. Al-Muhim, so I said, call her to Islam. When she becomes Muslim, Allahu Akbar, alhamdulillah. He left. And then a brother who was sitting, other than those two brothers, someone who was sitting there, he was hearing. He came to me. He said, "Ya Akhi, this, what are you saying, happened to someone he knows. He married that woman. Now his daughter go to the staking by the mother to the church Sundays. This person is grieving. His parents." And then he said, "This is what happened." So I called the brother back to just acknowledge him that someone who was there, that's what he gave me information. Amazing was what he said. He said, even the one who was with him, his friend, after they left me, he told him the same thing he said. He said, what he told you was true. And he mentioned an incident. But subhanAllah, still he was insisting to move forward. Subhanakallah wa bihamdik, la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.